Welcome back to the epic Final Fantasy Let's Play. What are we doing right now? Oh, we're going back to the Cave of Nightmares. That's what we're doing. Alright, so, welcome back. It's been, for you guys, a week. I'm trying to make sure to, always get at least one episode out a week, but usually two episodes out a week. So, for me, I'm probably uploading, or I'm recording either every week or every 2 weeks. But for you guys, you shouldn't be any farther behind than a week. So yeah, hopefully I'm done with the long breaks, and we could start hammering out Final Fantasy. Try to get through this one so that we can get to some of the more interesting ones. Not that this is a bad game, I'm enjoying this game, definitely. We got some more questions from the fans. Not a ton, but I glossed over it, and it looked like there were a couple people who asked a bunch of questions, so hopefully that's enough to keep us busy. And I think that's about it in terms of news. Seymour is sitting here next to me sleeping. I didn't kick him out of the room because he's sleeping, so I'm hoping he stays asleep. Right now he's awake. He's cleaning himself. I don't know if he's going to go back to sleep or not. If he starts doing crazy things, then I'm going to kick him out. Because he has a little bell on his collar, and it's really loud, and you guys don't need to listen to that. This is the wrong way. So, like I said, other than that, I don't think there's too much news. We had a really cool thing happen the other day. My Final Fantasy VII Glitches and Oddities video hit the YouTube main page. I'm guessing it was under gaming. I don't know. I didn't actually see it. But, so it got a bunch of views. It already had a good amount of views, but it got a big spike in views on that day. And so I'm pretty excited about that, especially since that's the video that I explain the Patreon and how it works and why we're doing it and why we need the help. So it's good that a lot of people got to see that. And hopefully the people who watched that went to watch on some of the other stuff. See, there he is. He's making noise. Seymour, quiet. Are you gonna walk around? Or are you gonna go back to sleep? Because if you're walking around, then I'm taking you upstairs. Because you're very loud. Yeah, you know what? He's got that look in his eye. He's about to do some things. So hold on, let me go grab him.
Come here.
All right. The Seymour has left the building. So that was really cool. We've had things like that happen in the past, but I'm glad to see that a video that I'm actually really proud of and worked really hard on got, the limelight and got some love from people. So, anyways, let's get to some questions because we're just kind of walking to this cave right now. I'm only focusing on on newer episodes for the questions. Like, if someone comments a question on, episode 2, I'm probably not gonna go back and answer it. So I'm hoping that everyone leaves their questions on the most recent episode. As long as you get your question in by the time I do my next recording session, which is usually on the weekend before the episodes come out, I should get to it, so just keep that in mind. But, this question I'm gonna answer even though it's on an old episode because I noticed it right now when I was looking through. The question is from Alec Toledo, and it is, what would you change about Final Fantasy VII? What would I change about Final Fantasy VII? Well, I wouldn't I wouldn't change anything, because it's the game I grew up with, like, with its good sides and its bad sides. It's the game I grew up with, it's the game I remember, so I wouldn't really change anything, but just so that, because that's kind of a lame answer, if you ask me, like, what's the one thing that could change about Final Fantasy VII to make it better? No, I'll think about that for a second. I think maybe if the glitches were fixed or never existed, you know. And I mean, it's a good and bad answer because honestly, growing up, I didn't care about the glitches because I didn't know about them. But I think now, maybe it ruins the game for some people, because anyone that knows about the glitches, like, just learned about them before they ever actually played the game, just because they watched a video or something, like, the W item glitch does kind of ruin the end of the game. Like, if you know about the W item glitch, which is not hard to learn about, like, it's, I think I figured it out on accident, so, what the hell is that? Gnoma? Gnoma? I don't know, but it's scary, and I don't like it. We're gonna use haste on Mike. Let's use fire. I'm wondering if this is like those other things that like only show up near chests and are like super hard. He... fucking fire, though. Do you see how much damage that did? That was insane. I'm doing it again. And I'm gonna cure... 2 on card. Oh, sweet. He died. 768 gil. Holy shit, that was amazing. Holy shit! 1,975 gil! We just made bank, ladies and gentlemen. We just made bank. Alright, okay, so, that was that. So anyways, about the glitches, yeah, like, the W item glitch is really easy to find out and is really game-breaking, so that's, like, one big thing. And then there's, like, the save crystal glitch, which breaks the game on accident, and I heard of a lot of people screwing up their save files, you know, with that. And then there's the Radon Midgar glitch, which you wouldn't know unless you looked it up, but if you do know it, you can skip a whole extremely important part of the game. And it's so easy to do. It's like, I'm glad that, well, I wouldn't say I'm glad that the glitches are there, but just, it's cool that the glitches are there and we can look at it, we can learn more about the game that we grew up with and stuff, but at the same time, if they weren't there, I feel like it would be a better game, you know? Because Final Fantasy VII is my favorite game, but I never tell people it's the best game ever, you know? Like, I never say that, because it did have a lot of problems. Even though it was revolutionary for the time, it had a lot of problems. They kind of rushed it to get it out at the end, and they had a lot of problems coding it, and there's just a lot of things that went wrong. So it's not a perfect game by any means, but I think if those glitches weren't there, it would be closer to perfect, you know? It would be easier for me to say it's one of the best games ever made, because it's like flawless in terms of the way it was put together and stuff. But I can't really say that, because they really didn't do such a great job putting that game together. There's a lot of problems with it. Whether or not you noticed them growing up or not, they're there. So that's probably what I would change. You know, I couldn't change anything about the story or how things play out. The other thing I would change, even maybe better than the glitches, would be a hard mode. I talked about this in my Final Fantasy VII Remake video where I talked about seven things I wanted and seven things I don't want. One of the things I really want to see in the remake is a difficulty setting. And I know that Final Fantasy pretty much never has a difficulty setting, but I just think it would be so nice if, you know, all these people that have mastered Final Fantasy VII, you know, walking into the remake, they had the ability to start it off harder. Because right now, Final Fantasy VII is too easy for us who have played it a million times. Like, I can get through that game, you know, I've done challenge runs of the game. But then you look at, like, other people who have done challenge, you know, super challenge runs of the game, you know, no materia, no low level, all that stuff, which I follow a lot of. And you can beat that game with next to nothing, you know. I mean, I think just the fact that you can beat the game without materia is kind of nuts, because that's like how the whole game is structured, is materia. And you can beat it without it pretty easily. Like, it's not even that hard to beat it without materia. So, it's... I wish there was... Oh, shit. We're poisoned. So I wish there was a way to make it more difficult without having to do challenge runs and stuff. I wish it was just like a hard mode where everything was more difficult and you had to do a little bit more grinding and a little bit more... You had to think about things a little more. Because Final Fantasy VII is one of those games that as long as you level up enough, you can just run through the game. You could just hit attack. You could just attack everything. There's no boss in the game that's immune to attack. You could just attack the whole game and probably win. Seymour! Seymour! Stop it! Hey! Crazy cat. What was I saying? Oh yeah, you could just run through the game, you know, pretty easily if you've beat it before. Now, when I was growing up, the game certainly wasn't easy, but as I've gotten older, I think that Final Fantasy VII is easier than some of the other RPGs on the PS1. Oh, it's another one of these fuckers. Like Legend of Dragoon is one that comes to mind, Legend of Legaia. Those games were much harder than Final Fantasy VII. I think. So, increased difficulty would be another thing I would change about Final Fantasy VII. Or at least the option for increased difficulty, you know? Doesn't have to be hard, but put the option there for people who have already played the game and loved it and want to play it again and not just completely demolish it. Now, see, there's a path up to the right, and I kind of want to see what's up there, but I'm going to go this way first. Cobras! Alright, while we're fighting cobras, let's look at some of these other questions. Okay, Jason Eastman has asked some more questions, and thank you, Jason, for leaving all these questions. He usually leaves a big list of questions for me to answer. And sometimes I can answer them and sometimes I can't, but it definitely gives me something to talk about, so I appreciate it. His first question is, what is your favorite job class in any Final Fantasy? That's easy, Thief. That's why I named Death the Thief Death. I've always liked the Thief class. And what sucks is the Thief class usually sucks. So, you know, it's kind of... Like, I like the Thief class, but... They get a bad rap half the time because they kind of suck usually. But I like daggers, and the thief usually gets to use daggers, so that's usually why they're my favorite. I also just like the speed, and you know, some of the skills they get in most of the games are cool, so definitely the thief class. Am I gonna fight another one of these things? Probably. Yep. I might actually, like, I might actually leave the cave after this, after I get this item. Because there's only one other way to go, so it's probably the correct way to go. And so if I leave and go save and heal up, then I can just come right to the cave and go directly that path, and I'll have all this exploration stuff saved in case I die. So I might do that. So yeah, favorite job class, thief. That was easy. And I have so much money to spend too. Crap, am I have to fight another one because I walked away? Son of a bitch. I fucked up, guys. Oh, don't kill Jack. Damn. Well, now I definitely gotta go heal. Oh crap, that was Jen too. And she's the only one with the revival skill. So now I gotta go all the way to another town just to revive her. Fuck. Son of a bitch. That's so much dick. I'm so mad now. Anaconda? Those are terrifying. Get the hell out of here right now. They can't do any damage to Mike, though. Unless they get a critical, apparently. Okay, next question. What is your favorite uniform, style, and look of any job class from any Final Fantasy? Huh. That's a good question. Thieves usually do look kind of cool, but I don't like them for their look. I always really liked the Black Mage look, you know, with the Kate, like, Vivi, how Vivi looks, you know, and, like, this Black Mage looks, like, his cool hat and black face. I always loved that. I always wanted a, they have plushies that look like that, and I always wanted one. So either that, or, I don't know why this came to mind, but, in Final Fantasy X-2, there's a class, because they actually, like, dress up for their classes, the dress spheres, and, there was one that was, like, Lady Luck, I think it was called, and they had, like, cards and red and, either white or red and black clothes, and that looked pretty sweet. I don't know why that came to mind, but it did, so I thought I'd mention it. Why is Yuna your favorite character in any Final Fantasy? I get she is good, but in my opinion, I feel like there are at least 6 or 7 better that come to mind immediately. Well, it depends on what you mean by good. She's my favorite character. I don't think she's the best character. She's really not that great. She has, you know, I don't want him to die, so I'm gonna use some potions. I got plenty of money to buy more. But you know, she's got the Aeons, and then she has like Holy and Auto Life. So she was actually pretty good in Final Fantasy X. But not until the end of the game. During the game she was pretty fucking useless. But she's my favorite character because of her story. I think it's one of the most relatable and cool stories in Final Fantasy period, at least in terms of character development. It's kind of hard to explain all together without spending like 2 hours on it, but I guess basically, you know, you meet her at the beginning of the game, and she can't think for herself. She has Kamari there to help her. And by the way, I'm gonna totally spoil Final Fantasy X. So if you haven't played Final Fantasy X, if I remember, I'll put an annotation here and let you skip. I'll tell you what time to skip to or something when I'm done talking about this. But if not, just skip ahead a little bit in the video. But anyway, so at the beginning of the game, she can't think of herself. She has Kamari to defend her. And all she wants to do is follow in her dad's footsteps. So that's basically her life. She wants to become a summoner just like her father, die to kill sin, and that's going to be her life. And she's going to make a bunch of people happy who she doesn't actually know or really care about. But she's just kind of following what it is that society and her father basically had led her to do. Well, her father didn't lead her to be a summoner, but she wants to be like her father, so indirectly he kind of did. I'm gonna go fucking revive shit now. Fucking bullshit. So she starts off like that. Then she meets Titus, and things start to change. She slowly becomes more able to fend for herself and think for herself. But she's still on her journey, kinda not for no reason, but like, there's not much really. If you were to ask Yuna at that point, like, why are you doing this, she wouldn't really have a great answer. Like, her answer would just be like, oh, well, my father did it, and I think I should do it because I can help people. And that's basically all she could really say. But then, near the end of the game, the whole this is my story thing that Final Fantasy X kind of revolves around, she gives this speech right before you fight Unalaska. And it's my favorite speech ever. It's absolutely incredible. She talks about how it's her story, and she needs to make her own decisions. And it's hard to quote now. Like, you have to go watch it to really get the full gist of it. But at that point, she becomes kind of independent and realizes that she needs to do what it is she needs to do for herself. And she says, I can't remember the exact quote. Hold on. I'm gonna look it up. I'm gonna look it up real quick. Okay, here it is. So she says, they're just about to go into Unalaska's chambers, and she says, "Wait, you say it's your story, but it's my story too, you know? It would be so easy to let my fate just carry me away, following the same path my whole life through. But I know I can't. What I do with no regrets." And that's like, it's so, like, the words themselves aren't that, you know, it's no Shakespeare. But it's so pivotal, because the whole game up to that point, that's near the end of the game, the whole game up to that point, she was literally just following the road as it was. Every time you go to a temple, you know, okay, now we just go to the next temple. Okay, now we just go to the next temple. Oh, okay, now it's time to go to Xarnakin. And she's just kind of following the path the way it's been led out in front of her, regardless of what that actually means in the end. But here she finally stops and she says, you know what, everyone's been talking about their damn story, but this is my story too. And I can't just let fate carry me away and just keep following this road without even thinking about it. What I do, I need to do with no regrets. So she knows now that she needs to be doing this for the right reason. And then they go into Unalaska's chambers, and they realize that Yuna's gonna have to die. And they go, that's like the pivotal moment in the game where they say, nope, we're not just going to do it the way everyone else has done it. We're going to do something different. Even if it means we fuck up and sin lasts forever, we're willing to take that chance. And if she hadn't come to that realization at that moment, that wouldn't have happened. She would have just taken Unalaska's thing, died, sin would have died, and then everything would have just kept going on as normal. So that was like the big pivotal moment where everything changes. And I always just really liked her character, because it's so relatable, you know? You go through your life going to school, and you're like, you know, I'm just going... If you ask, like, kids why they're in school, they'll usually tell you because their parents made them. And then sometimes even college students, you know, why are you in college? Oh, because it was the next thing after school, you know? That's exactly the reason I went to college. I didn't even really think about it enough. I just went because it was, okay, I went to school, now I go to college. But there's a moment in your life when you decide, I need to do things for myself, and I need to start making decisions for reasons that I will not regret later. And I need to just actually go and do things without being regretful, and just, well, however they pan out, that's the way they pan out. That's kind of when you become a grown-up, really, in my opinion. When you start doing things regardless of what happened, you accept the results of your decisions. You accept the results of your actions. So you're no longer going through life saying, oh, well, someone else told me to do that, so that's why it happened, you know. If something broke, you know, and you ask a kid, like, oh, how'd the lamp break? It's never, almost never going to be because I tripped and fell and hit it. It's going to be, well, I was rushing because you told me to clean the house and I tripped. And, you know, it's always someone else's fault. I'm not saying all kids are jerks or anything. I'm just saying, like, in general, even in your own head, you think that. You think, you know, well, why did this happen? Oh, it wasn't my fault. It was something else that led me to rush or do something like that. But there comes a point in your life when you start actually blaming yourself and saying, you know, I have no regrets of the stuff I'm doing now. This is all the things that I chose, and whatever happens, happens, and I have to deal with it. So it's kind of like her story is a coming-of-age story for everyone. And I just always really, really, really liked that idea. And also, her character development is incredible. You know, it's because you meet her, and she's nowhere close to that. And then you take this big journey with her, and you slowly get to see her get closer to that. And then she finally hits it at the end. And then, you know, there's the whole thing with Titus after you beat Sin. And it's such a beautifully written and packaged together story. So that's why she's my favorite character. Do I want Heal 2? Or Cure 3? I need some items first before I buy magic. So yeah, that's why she's my favorite character. I would never say she's the best character. Especially since she totally goes downhill in Final Fantasy X-2. And I beat Final Fantasy X-2, but I don't claim to understand anything that happened in Final Fantasy X-2. The story makes no fucking sense to me, and I don't get it. And I haven't tried very hard to get it, so... Is there no item shop here? Really? There's no item shop here. How did I not notice that? Well, I feel like a doofus. I might just buy some super expensive. There's really nothing. There's not much for me to buy. I already bought life, right? But I can't use it yet because she's not high enough level. Yeah. So, I'm gonna buy some black magics. Fire 3, poison, instantly annihilates foes. Now how do I not pick that? warps, party to previous 4, slow 2. I want to get Fire 3, but can you use it yet? Yes, you can. You can use 1. I'm buying it. Oops. Nope, stop. There we go. So, I hope that was a good answer for you. If not, I don't care, because it's my opinion, so...